Hey everyone. So I notice a lot of time between videos these days. Quite frankly, I'm not in such a big hurry anymore. Now that my bench is together, I have time to breathe. I have room to breathe in my schedule to be able to do other things and whatnot. But I am, rest assured, I am still working on the bench. It's just, you know, when you're doing all of the rough work, we'll call it, building the frame, laminating the tops, laminating the aprons, doing all the milling of all the lumber involved in this sucker, mortise and tenon, pegging, I mean, all that stuff. All that stuff is, yes, time-consuming, but it feels time-consuming while you're doing it, but it's still a whole lot faster than the finished work, right? So when you're doing rough work, it goes faster. When you're doing finished work, it takes longer. It's just kind of a fact of life, right? With anything that you're doing. So I wanted to kind of go over a few things that I've been doing. This side, the front side, the front top, is still higher than the rear side. And I've been working on it for a day and a half now, slowly. But it's still higher. But I wanted to kind of go over a few of the tools and techniques that I'm using to get this unorthodox style of bench flat. Because you have two pieces. I know I've talked a little bit about this, but not really in depth, I guess. So you have two slabs that you have to not only get flat, no twist, square, everything is good to go on that side and this side, but you also have to get them parallel to one another, level to one another. And this bench is 7 foot long and like 33 inches wide. So 33 inches wide by 7 feet long. To do that, you need some big stuff. As I had mentioned, I was going to pick up, and I did. I picked up an 8 foot level. Home Depot sells these. They're made by Empire. I want to say I paid, I get a military discount, but I think I paid right about 90 bucks for this thing. And this guy was like 35 or something like that. They're made by Empire. They're box levels. So you have two main types of levels. You have I-beam levels and you have box levels. And the box level is obviously... Oh, I say obviously. If it was that obvious, I wouldn't be saying anything. Box levels are more accurate than your I-beam levels. Your I-beam levels are more flexible. Not that they're not good and won't do certain things, but your box levels are, well, they're more accurate. They're better. I will say, when you get a level, you don't store your levels on the bench or on a work surface, on the floor, leaning up against your couch, right? These suckers have to be stored vertically, like hanging from something or something of that nature, preferably hanging from something or suspended in the air by something. Now, this is an 8 foot level, and so obviously I can't put it in here because the ceiling's not even 8 feet. So I store mine in the living room of my main cabin, the main room of my cabin, and yeah, I have vaulted ceilings in there. So that's where this guy stays. I'm a single guy, though, so I don't care about that. Adds to the ambiance, if you will. But if you're married or something like that, you'll want to. I don't know. Maybe your garage has ceilings that high. Usually they do. High enough to store an 8-foot level, anyway. And so, anyway, moving on. So some of the ways that I'm measuring. Right now, I've been concentrating on the front slab. And so, focusing on the front slab, I've been doing a few things that you've seen before and a few things that you haven't seen before. Right, so I'm going through and I'm checking for flatness, because I want to get this slab perfect before I start, or as in the same, at the same time it's happening, right? But I want to get this side as close to perfect as I can get it before I start lowering it to match that side. Now, don't get me wrong, they're really close. They're within an eighth of each other, but the more meat I take off trying to get this perfect, what I don't want to do is get this perfect, and by the time it's perfect, it's lower than this one, and then I have to do the same thing, and then I just keep going back and back, and before you know it, or back and forth, and before you know it, my bench top is only an inch and a half thick. So that's why I'm taking my time. I'm being patient. I'm going very slow and methodical trying to get this right the first time. And so, yeah. So I'm going across this way. I'm looking for light. I'm rocking it back and forth, and I'm looking for light. I have light coming in through the other window so I can see where my light is. And where I have a high spot, right there I'm rocking. So I mark where it's rocking, and then I go back and forth on either side of it to find out where that rock starts. So I've been taking just about a foot and working that 1 foot until I get it where I want it. Now what I'm looking for is when I rock it this way, I see how far the light goes, and then I see, okay, well that's at the 11, where my 11 is on my 11 inch mark on my rule. And then when I rock it back this way, the light goes to, say, the 14, so I mark that one line, and that's what I remove in the distance of wherever it's rocking. And that's not going to give me perfect, because that just tells me the exact width of my high spot. You still have to feather it into the rest of it. So what I usually do is take a couple passes on that. And me personally, I would rather have a slight hollow than to where all my boards that I'm working on are sitting flat with a couple thousandths underneath them than have a bow where my piece is rocking back and forth as I'm trying to plane it or whatever. So I'm doing this, right? This takes a long time, so I'm not going to sit and bore you with this all day. So I'm doing that. I'll go and make a couple passes in that direction, then I'll take my number 8 and I'll run it back and forth to make sure that it stays close to level, right? Something else that I've been doing though, because I can't count right now anyway, I can't count on my aprons to be exactly square, so I can't sit and do this number yet, right? If I tried to do that, I'd be way off. My top would be way off. Because I have to match this guy over here. So, what I'm doing... Well, before I go to start matching that, what I have been doing with this to find the high spots in here also... So I go with this and I rock back and forth and I find the high spots by looking for light underneath the rule. But I also take I take a straight edge and I have 9 boards, right? So 8 boards plus the apron gives me 9 boards. So I just place it on my dot on the fifth board, right in the middle, and this should give me a sanity check on things as I move along. I just put my finger on it and I start pushing it along. And you can see it's dragging pretty good right there, so that's why I want to mark that. Then you straighten it out and continue going. So it's still dragging right there. And I'll just keep going kind of so I can remember where the marks are. So that's where it stops dragging, so that's where I stopped marking it. Now it's starting to drag on the other side. Now, every foot or so, I'm going to bring it back and kind of give it a test, because if you have a high spot right here and you're doing this number, it will sit and swivel on it on its own. That'll let you know that you don't have any high spots. See, I'll find that high spot right here that I was just dragging on. As I was pushing, it started dragging right there. So that's a high spot, and it'll sit and swivel on its own because that's now its fulcrum, right? Or it's, is that right? So it's still dragging right here. Now if you're centered on everything and... I'm not worried about the little tiny catches, but I'll mark them and take a shaving off. It's the big hooks that I care about. Alright, so it stops dragging there again. So it's dragging here, a little bit here, and dragging here. Just a hair right there. I've never seen this technique used, and maybe I'm flawed. My technique is flawed, but it makes sense to me, so that's the way I'm doing it. So now I'll just go take, and I will go ahead and take a little bit off here. That's kind of justified because that's the only spot it's taken off is right where I put my marks. Thank you.
forest, old growth forests, campfire, great spending right outdoors.
And you always want to make sure when you're doing checking things like this for square, flatness, whatever, get all the chips off, all the shavings, sawdust and everything, get it off your tool. I'm not saying this is going to be perfect, but it'll be better than what it was. Alright, so still a little high there.
Crystal Geyser, always refreshing, always available. Listen to Sounds of the Source at Crystal Geyser Please Radio.
No, it's not catching here, it's catching right here. I have a little sap pocket right there. When it starts to turn, I'll come back and go slowly over it. Right there, where it's like a knot, where the grain is kind of irregular. Gotta take these spots off. Now you don't want to take too much off there because then your fulcrum's gonna change, your pivot point's gonna change. Especially be careful on the edges, is what I mean. I know it seems like a lot as far as going back and forth and back and forth, but for me, as a relative beginner, now I say beginner, I've been fabricating stuff all my life since I've been making stuff forever. In the Navy, that's all I grew up doing. I don't do it as much anymore because I'm, you know, as you move up the ladder in any business, you stop really working your trade and you're more pushing paper and dealing with personnel issues and stuff. But yes, my guys, I still get out there and make stuff and stay engaged in the trade. Mainly teaching, but a lot of teaching, you know, in trade work is getting behind the machinery and going to town. Of course, I for those of you that don't know, I run a machine shop. The machine shop and weld shop and pipe fitting shop and carpentry shop on the USS Nimitz. Out of Washington. It's an aircraft carrier, if you didn't know. I'm the repair officer there. And so I have, before I became an officer, my background was in machining. So, I know the machining side of the house very well, but I also run the weld shop, and obviously I know the carpentry side of the house. But when it comes to pipe fitting and ship fitting, welding and stuff like that, yeah, I don't know. Those young men and women teach me more about that than I ever will teach them about my stuff. But so I like to get over there from time to time and dabble in all that stuff. They helped me make my fab up the maker's mark that I'll be bringing home to throw my maker's mark on the bench. And any other large project like my beds or my furniture out here, it'll all get my brand, my maker's mark. So you'll see that coming soon. And yeah, I had to make a weld repair to my other woodworking, my other bench vise. I'm going to mount one vise here that I have actually on the floor underneath the bench. Let me break it out. So you guys can all see it. I took the wooden jaws off of it only because I'm going to make my own chops. But this one I bought, so I wanted one that was ready to go out of the box, so to speak. It's an old vise, but it's a Wilton, and the vise chops are going to eventually be made out of this piece of maple, which I started playing with just to see what the figure, if it had any in it, was like, but I got this, it's dried, it's got some figure in it, I don't know if you can't tell, but I was really just going for maple. I wasn't expecting there to, it was all rough cut, so I couldn't see the grain. So we'll see how that plays out. I don't know if I really want curly maple as my chops, but we'll make them, and if they don't work, then we'll switch them out. They're easy enough, right? So this guy will get mounted below the bench. Right here, so and this vise is so smooth and it's beautiful. The guy or gal that restored it did a wonderful job. But it does have the little pop-up dog, so I want to keep it level with the bench, at least enough to where this is actually functioning. So if I mounted at the bottom of the bench top and just put the jaws up taller to be level with the bench, then, you realize the bench top itself, right now it's a little more than an inch and 5/8. Right at. It'll be a little bit lower than that. Or, sorry, 4 5/8. And from the bench top, it's only 2 1/4 from where you mount it to the bench. Or, you know, that only 2 1/4 of it will be taken up. So I'm still going to have all of that meat left out there. So if I say this goes all the way to 4 1/2 inches, this will soak up 2 1/2 inches, and then I'll still have another, or 2 1/4, and I'll still have another 2 1/4 inches. It'll only take up half of the bench thickness. So this is twice as thick as any normal bench that this would be mounted on. I hope that makes sense. So I either have to recess it in or I go from the bottom. And if I do that, obviously this bench dog only goes up so far. And is not... If I mount it straight to the bottom, this dog will not reach up to do me any good because my boards will be up at this height. So lifting this dog, I'd have to drill some holes and put some dogs in the top of the vise, which is fine. Because my vise chop and my rear, or the adjustable one anyway, will be good and thick to be able to do that. I don't plan on messing around. I'm only going to make it once if I can get away with the wood that I've got. I think curly maple will be just fine. It's harder than anything, than most of the other stuff I have. Not everything. I have Osage Orange sitting over there, but that's not for the chops. At least that's not the plan right now. Anyway, I just kind of wanted to show you guys the vise that I'll be working with. It did come with these two cherry pieces right here, but I went to go screw it in, and I have brass screws. That was a bad idea. I don't know why I even thought of that. I thought they were bronze screws, so they'd be harder, but, yeah, anyway. Snapped off in there, and that's how I cut my thumb the other a couple weeks ago. I was trying to dig that out of there, but, I don't know. It'll become something, but these aren't going to be jaws anymore. So, yeah, that's the vise. It will be mounted exactly right here. Only on the bottom side. So getting back to how I'm going about making sure this is good to go is getting this bench top flattened and level and everything. What I'm also doing is using my shorter forefoot and I can span across, and I know that this side's lower. Now, it's not flat this way either. It's a little higher on this side than it is on this side in certain spots. But I know right now I'm not touching anywhere on this bench, on this side of the bench. So I place it right in the middle, and I am awesomely, perfectly level right there. And this is what I'm going to go off of, because I can't square off of here, off of this apron. So I'm going straight off of a level. I'm sitting in my house on a tile floor. It's about as level as I can hope to get. And so I'm just going to keep going. And you can kind of move it back and forth like a straight edge and find out if you have any pivot points. Just like I was doing with the other, with the winding sticks. And so I'm just moving it right now. So I can see that it's just a hair, like it needs to be some taken off right in this area because it's just a smidge out of level right there. And I have a rock right here, so I can feel the rock this way, and I can see it in the bubble which one is more level. And right now it's actually equally off of either side of that peak right here. So I need to take that peak out, and I can feel that peak. So I'm doing this. I'm going down the entire bench this way, right? Something else that I'm doing, that's the whole reason I bought this big guy. The whole reason I bought this big guy was to see, you know, what if any, are my hills and peaks and valleys or whatever on the top. Now, it was pretty flat after, because I got it, and the last thing to touch this was my eight, my number eight joiner plane. And it was pretty flat, but since then I've been taking other material off here and there, as you've been saw, as you saw in the first video, or in the beginning of the video. And so now it's touching here in this last 10 inches or so. And then there's a small gap, but it's pretty even until I get to like the last 10 inches here. So so it's riding on the front, or on the left side and the right side of the top. And so I'll need to take those ends down. And then I'll just keep moving it. I'm gonna literally do it every couple inches. And we'll go from there. Something else I'm looking at, and thank freaking God, I'm level. So I'm not, my bench isn't going one way or the other. I guess another good way you could test that is to get like a little, I used to have them sitting all over the place. Get a marble. Well, these are for my slingshot. I'm gonna go kill that damn cat that's poking around in my yard. But as you can tell, I mean, if it was really off, this sucker would be shooting all over the place. But it's really only going wherever I kind of, the momentum I give it. So, I mean, that's proof in the pudding right there that, you know, putting a little bit of extra time and effort into what you're doing is really going to pay off in the end. Now with these bench top, the ends of the bench being taller, look, see, it's going downhill. You probably can't even see that. But, so the ends, remember the ends are a little bit higher than the rest, so, of course it sits there. It's like finding that one little groove. There it goes. So it's rolling and then it stops. So like right up in there, that's my... That's this last little bit is where it's touching. So I'm using a bunch of little techniques that maybe you have seen, maybe you haven't seen. I don't know. But then I'm going to go corner to corner too, to make sure. I mean, I don't know how thick that is, because I can't measure it with a pair of calipers or anything. More shits and giggles. I have an old set of feeler gauges here that I'm going to restore. They're not in terrible shape or anything, but here's one that's 5/1000ths. Alright, so I can get 5/1 under there. But even that's catching. It's even pivoting on there. So that's about how much of the distance we're talking about. 5/1000ths. 5/1000ths. Should I be worried about that? Probably not. Let's jump it up to 7/1000ths. Yeah, it won't even go under there. So, those are the measurements I'm talking about. That's how close this bench top is to being flat all the way across. I literally have to take a couple shavings over here, a couple shavings over there. Be very careful and get it right where I want it. Yeah, I mean, it's not sliding anywhere. So I go corner to corner and check it out. That's the same there. Actually, it is a little bit, there's more of a gap here. I haven't done this yet on this side, so kind of doing this together. There is a little bit more of a gap here, probably, if I was a betting man, or quite a bit more of a gap. Let's break these out. I'm thinking maybe about 20 thou or so. Maybe more than that. Biggest gauge I got is 25 thousandths. So 25 even fits under there. So you can see it's much better, bigger. But what does that tell you, right? The wood's speaking to me, right? So if it's only 5 thousandths here of a gap, but if I go here, it's probably closer to like 30, 35 thousandths underneath the level here. So that tells me that right off the bat that I should make another, check it a different way, but that part and right there are higher than their counterparts. All right, so this is higher than this, and that's higher than that. So these are some of the things that you need to think about, right? So you wouldn't have seen that if you never did this and all you did was go this way and step it across and then use your shorter level to go this way. You never would have noticed that one was taller than the other because what is that telling me? What's another way I can check what I just did, what I just found out? Right? These winding sticks are going to tell me, this is my validation, my verification, that what I'm being told, and I haven't done this yet, but this is my verification that what I'm being told with my level is accurate, because this will tell me that this spot, when I look down this, I should see, because it's high on that end and close to me on this end, I should see, it won't be that drastic, it'll be very slightly, but I should look at it and see that. Okay, so let's just see. I haven't looked yet. So, probably be better with my darker one at the other end, but. And what do you know? I can barely see it, so I'm going to switch them. And in dim light, I'm glad I went this way. With two dark, or two different colored, a dark and a light wood, because right now when it's light outside, it's good to have the dark one at the other end. When it starts getting darker and you're an outside woodworker like me, when you can be, at nighttime, it's much better to have the light colored one, especially when you're using lights. And yeah, it's very evident, well, to me, because I've been doing this a little bit, but this side's high and this side's high. The corners are high. So I do need to take down some material in them corners, but then I got to go with the level and find out where. So this is a third one that will tell me, third way that will tell me which side needs to be taken off, right? Because removing material right here, this whole quadrant, will be the same, will give me the same effect as taking all the material down in that quadrant. Taking material down that quadrant. Now right here, make sure you're not touching. Now I'm perfectly level right here. Perfectly level, right? Now if I take it down here, I think I'm gonna find that I'm slightly like that. Make sure I'm not touching the other bench. And I'm closer on that side. I've got like that much, an eighth or so over there, but not as much over here. So one of the sides is kind of like this, right? So you're not looking, you're not paying attention just to twist this way, but you also have to worry about twist this way. Right? I know there's a lot to measuring this. You don't really think about it till you get in, but yeah. So if you look, well, you probably can't see it, but I'm just sticking that right there. Right, so that tells me that this side is high. So this is the part, this is the section that we knew was high. We thought that one might be high, but that one's level. So all my material needs to come off of this corner. Because if I start taking material off of that corner, then I'm no longer going to be level over there. It's going to be low. So this is why it is taking me so long. Because I'll kind of take all my measurements. I'll mark where I know I need to go, right? So I did one little step at a time in this video, but what I've been doing is kind of take my measurements, and there will be marks, different kind of marks, so I know where I got the mess, you know. So these X marks come from my levels, right? And my winding sticks. So I know they're twist marks. And then the line, the squiggly lines come from my rule. And that way I know, and I'll have marks all over this bench. I'll mark on it also like H and L, high or low. As far as whether it's high or low, if I'm marking it as a high or a low, usually I'm just marking high spots. And then I'll mark it with like a numeral, like a Roman numeral, like one is light, two is medium, and three would be a heavy cut. So if I need to take a heavy cut, then I'll mark a 3. If I need to take a light cut over here, I'll mark a 1. So I'll mark the entire bench up, and then I'll take all the tools off, I'll work it, and then I'll bring all the tools back on and take all my measurements again and see how I sit. So it's very time consuming. Do I really need to do all this? No, I don't. But
car takes care of you. Take care of it.
But I'm gonna do it any damn way, because that's how I roll. And this video is so damn long, my coffee got cold on me. So if you have any better suggestions, because I don't have a whole lot of experience, obviously. In leveling something this big, I'm just applying what I know from smaller objects. If you see something that's like, why is he doing that? Just do this. Or, gosh, why he's making his life a whole lot harder. Why doesn't he just do it this other way and not that way? Or whatever. Frickin' leave me a comment. Throw a dude a bone. So once they are together, they are one, then obviously the bench will be shoved over a little bit that way, and these guys will go just like so as winding sticks. So I'll know where's high and where's low. And then I can try to make sure it's good that way. So now I'm treating it as one unit. Now I will know, I'll know the flatness, I'll know everything like that. I'll know pretty much whether those twist or not when my rule doesn't get stopped. Right? Because right now when I come across, it just rolls right over. But if I come across this way, it gets jam stopped. And so right now it looks like I'm high here and here, which I am. I know I'm high here. So when I pull that down, guess what? That's going to exaggerate this even more, so I know I'm already high here. So, and the last piece of the puzzle, once I've done that, is to, run this down the length just as I did with each section, and then... See how nice that just sits right in there? And then you go corner to corner on this guy, right? You go corner to corner in here. And that corner to corner. And you'll measure the gap and the distance between those two, and that should be the last one. So I should be level from here to here, here to here, here to here, here to here. I should be level, fully flat, all the way across this way. All the way across in different spots of the bench this way. And then this way and the other way, lengthwise, the other side. And then no twist. And then I should be able to go, at that point, I should be able to go around with this all over the entire bench and find nothing. Anything that's not flat, so it has to be flat, no twist, and the last thing, as I'm doing all those with my levels for final check, there's a reason I got levels, not just as a straight edge, right? I can't use the square, I have to use the level. So the whole time I'm doing this, I'm making sure that bubble is dead center. And I'll tell you, a lot of people don't use levels, don't whatever. I'll tell you move that thing a couple thousandths, you're gonna see that bubble move. And if you have a trained eye, you can tell. when you have equal distance between the ends of the bubbles and your lines. So that is that. That is what I am doing where I stand. Here it is Sunday. Sunday afternoon. And this is painstaking because it's the finish work, right? It's painstaking, and it feels like you're going nowhere with it. Feels like I'm getting nowhere, but every day I get a little bit closer. That's the top starts dropping. I get a little bit closer in my tweaking of everything, and it's all starting to come together. So hopefully. The patience that anybody has to put into this is starting to pay off. I was really hoping to get to mounting my vise this weekend, but I'll get to mounting the vise when I get to mounting the vise. Once the bench is flat, then I'll mount the vise. I'm not. My goal, it's not that I'm not setting goals, but my goal is to get the damn bench top flat. So I'm not going to worry about anything else other than the bench top being flat. Flat, parallel, true, no twist. Everything is good and right. Once that's done, then we'll start looking at mounting the bent, the mounting the mounting the vise. So if you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave me a comment down below. And can't remember your name, but the other dude that's been texting or messaging me that's building the same bench or a similar bench, you know. Good on you, man. If you watched my whole series and you're ready to tackle this, You're getting ready to tackle this, which I know there are other people doing the same thing because I've messaged a couple people, but the fact that you have watched like what almost, well, this is I guess video number 50, all 50 videos of this bench build, do you know how long it takes for the novice, the amateur to do it? I'm not a professional woodworker, and I'm surely not a hand tool professional. Still learning. We're all the way. I'll be 80 years old still learning. So, but good on you, man. If you're going to build a bench, you got my support, brother. If you have any questions or anybody has any questions, ask. Just ask. I will share my experience with you and give you any piece of advice I can. I may just work on this a little bit more, but I was going to wait to the end and maybe I'll just skip because it is kind of the end of the bench really, other than the vices and flattening the bench. I've been journaling things along the way for this build, lessons learned, things like that that may help everybody out. Kind of condense all the lessons into one compact setting. So that's it, I guess. I'm gonna get back to work on this. Or maybe I'll take a break and I'll get to making the video on the other. Who knows? If I'm going to do that, I probably should do it while there's still a light out. So maybe I'll see you later, maybe I won't. But the bench is still coming along, slowly but surely. And, you know, 6 months from now, I'm not saying it'll take 6 months from now. My buddy Roger's like, yeah, he'll still be doing this thing in 6 months. It will be built in 6 months. 6 months from now, I'll be pumping out videos on some other project. 6 months from now, this will be a joyful memory, building the bench. It'll be probably filthy as hell and all tore up, nicks and gouges all in it. It's probably not going to be level at that point anymore. But I will have my sturdy, once was flat and true workbench when it's all said and done. So if it does go out, it'll just be in little tweaks here and there. So might see you soon, might not, I don't know. Friends and family, as always, I love you. And to all the fathers out there, happy Father's Day. And I'm a grandpa and a father. And I already got and talked to all my kids. And yeah, they wished me a happy Father's Day and all that good stuff. So to all you fathers out there, happy Father's Day. And I'll see you soon. Cordless Carpenter out.